For the Lord shall comfort Zion, he will comfort all her waste places, and he will make her wilderness like Eden, and her deserts like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness shall be found therein, thanksgiving and the voice of melody. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might, through the thanksgiving of many, rebound to the glory of God. Will you please turn with me to our hymn this morning? Now thank we all our God. Please rise and bow with me. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, how wonderful is your name. How glorious is it that we should be your people. From your imagination, one grain of seed multiplies into bushels and brings nourishment to our bodies. You cast forth your living word to feed the deepest hunger of mankind. The harvest of grain of are gathered in and are tucked safely away for the winter days. But we still struggle to bring in the harvest you intend your word to bring. We are thankful for your kindness, but most especially we thank you for the perfect gift you sent to us in the form of your Son, Jesus Christ. You have given us everything we need to plant the grain, to grow it, to harvest and to store it, to turn it into the bread to feed upon. Your holy word creates the fertile field. Help us to plant the perfect seed of Jesus Christ so all may come to the nourishment of salvation which we may feed upon for all eternity. Thank you for your love and your many blessings. Allow us to come before you this day with our songs and our praise and our worship. For it's in the name of our blessed Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Our hymn, Come Ye Thankful People, Come. You may be seated.
Come ye thankful people, come. son, unto joy or sorrow's grown. First the blade and then the ear, then the full corn shall appear. Lord of harvest, grant that we wholesome grain and pure may be.
For the Lord of God shall come and shall take his harvest home from his feet.
Responsive reading this morning is from Psalms 100, 4 and 5. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise.
Be thankful unto him and bless his name.
For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting.
And his truth endureth to all generations.
Amen. And bless the reading of God's word. Well, our young people come up and they've got a couple of songs they want to sing for everyone, and you're welcome to join in.
I like to think about the goodness of the Lord. Gives me everything I need and so much more. So I just want to lift my hands and say that I love him. I just want to lift my heart in praise. And I want to be thankful. I want to be grateful. I want to remember everything that the Lord has done. I like to think about the goodness of the Lord. He gives me everything I need and so much more. So I just want to lift my hands and say that I love him. I just want to lift my heart in praise. And I want to be thankful. I want to be grateful. I want to remember everything that the Lord has done. I want to be thankful. I want to be grateful. I want to be, I want to be, I want to be thankful. I want to be grateful. I want to remember everything that the Lord has done.
Good job. They got one more that they're gonna. As we continue in our Thanksgiving.
gather together to ask the Lord's blessing. Guide us, our God, with us joining, ordaining, maintaining His kingdom divine. So from the beginning, the fight we were winning, our Lord was at our side, all glory divine.
Memory verse for this month is Romans 3:28. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. Romans 3:28. Amen. All right. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. It's good to see all of you here this morning. And I know it was when I was out with the bus picking up kids, I had some white stuff dropping all around the, and I had to have the blinkers or the windshield washers on. And boy, I'm telling you, it seems like we were just here just a short time ago. And I've got bulbs yet that I got to get in the ground, so I'm praying that God will give us a little bit more time to get some of those things done. But boy, coming here this morning, that's everything is, all the rivers and that are really up full. We've had a lot of rain around the area, so it's good to see all of you. It's good to have you here in the house of the Lord this morning as we celebrate Thanksgiving this week. Our kids are off most of the week, so we won't have. We won't have our teen program. We won't have our Kid Fusion program Wednesday and Thursday because the kids are off, so they get a break from us for a week, and then today we have potluck, so we have a good potluck planned for today. And I know that this is the holiday season, and a lot of times during the holiday season, people really get into a time where they need counseling. They need to talk to somebody. And if you're in that situation that you need to talk with someone, give us a call out here at the church and I'm flip over here to the number right there, Community Bible Church, and 814-967-3628. And you can give me a call out here and see about getting you into some counseling and hopefully it'll bring you along in life, make your life a better, smoother place to live. Again, we're still looking for Sunday school teachers, and what's coming up pretty soon? We're going to have, besides potluck today, you know, Thanksgiving is this week. And then I think in 2 weeks we're going to have a meeting today of everybody but in a couple of weeks we're going to probably have our Thanksgiving Christmas dinner for the community, so we'll have to plan that. And then after that, coming at a hurricane speed is Christmas, so we need to deal with that as well. So. And if you're at home and you want to help us with the Christmas project, you can do that. You can write us at Community Bible Church or me, Reverend Babcock, and you can send us a card, a thank you, a praise request, or a prayer request, or whatever, at P.O. Box 41, Titusville, 16354. Any other announcements that I need to make today? All right. Is there any praises, God working wonderful miracles in your life? I know for me, I was pretty out of it Thursday. I had to drive the bus to pick up kids, but I wasn't feeling very good Thursday. But I'm better today, so I got a little bit of congestion in my chest, but I'm getting better. So I praise the Lord for that. Yes.
My dad had a very deadly disease, and they said he could have had like a really bad stage of cancer, and he could have been dead in 2 years. But he has everything except cancer. So that means he's
going to
be okay.
So, all right. Well, that's a praise as well for her dad. All right. Anyone else this morning have a praise? God working wonderful things, miracles in your lives. How about prayer requests? Any prayer requests? Mike? Yes. Okay. Mike, okay, your mom is going to have surgery, or she had it?
She's soon
going to have the surgery. Okay, so we'll keep your mom's foot in prayer. Linda. Linda and her knees and that we'll keep in prayer as well. Yes, okay. For those that are sick, yeah. Today, yes. Yes, Jordan.
That my brother finds his dog.
And your brother finds what?
His dog.
Oh, his dog. Okay. Anyone else this morning?
I want to thank my son for being such a wonderful son, and he takes care of his mother.
Anyone else is Gene? You raised your.
We need to keep the Nichols family friends.
That's yes. All right, and then we need prayer for the church and prayer for one another as we get ready. I'm telling you, this season we've just had a lot of stuff come at us this year, and I don't know if I've ever felt less prepared for what's coming than I feel now, but we'll get there and then you at home, I know that you have your prayer requests, and if you will lift those up to the Lord now, certainly the Lord knows all of our prayer requests, everything that we need. We have unspoken requests and that we don't want people to know about, but we have those unspoken requests that we lift up to the Lord as well. And so now is the time for you to think about those requests that you're making and those praises that you have for the Lord as well. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the things that you do for us. We thank you for our kids and our young people and for our church and all the things that go on around here. We thank you for all the adults who work so hard to do so much. We thank you for giving us the opportunity to witness in this community, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we ask you to help us to continue to grow this mission, this church here in this area. To knit us close together as a strong Bible family, knowing how to live and survive and be close to you. We ask you to be with this country and watch over all of those who serve this country in the military and our firemen and policemen and all of those who wear uniforms, whether they're here or far away, to be with them, especially through this Thanksgiving time, that they will come and give thanks to you for the abundance of all that we have. We just ask you to continue to watch over them as well and be with them and their families, to make this a special season for all of them and all of us as well. Watch over our children and keep them strong and healthy. Continue to help us to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Continue to be with those that are watching from home, to be with their prayers as well. We ask you to be with Mike's mom as she gets ready for surgery. We ask you to be with Linda and all of those that are out this morning sick. We ask you to be with the Nichols family and Jordan's brother. We ask you to be with all of those who have unspoken requests as well. Guide us and lead us. Help us to be what we need to be. Help us learn how to live a life that's pleasing to you. Thank you so much for all that you've done for us. For it's in Jesus' precious name that we pray. Amen. I had a praise that I thought about for a long, long time, almost since the beginning of time that we came here. We have had a huge Home Depot bill every month. And this month, we still have some Home Depot bill to pay, but this month we finally paid. It was like having a mortgage burning kind of thing, because finally paid off the really, really big bill that we had on time. And I think we ought to be thankful and for that as well. All right, will you please follow with me for the beauty of the earth? Finished our books before, and Ezra, and so we're moving on. And I'm going to hit you with another one, probably, that nobody's ever read or preached out of. But how many of you have ever heard a sermon out of the book of Obadiah? So we're going to go, and surprisingly, you know, Obadiah, this, you know, is there's a lot in this book in the Old Testament. Obadiah comes just before Jonah. So Obadiah 1 through 9. This is a vision of Obadiah. This is what the Almighty Lord says about Edom. We have heard a message from the Lord. A messenger was sent among the nations to say, "Get ready. Let's go to war against Edom. Edom, I will make you the smallest of nations. Others will despise you. Your arrogance has deceived you. You live on rocky cliffs. You make your home up high. You say to yourself, 'No one can bring me down to earth,' even though you fly high like an eagle and build your nest among the stars. I will bring you down from there, declares the Lord. If thieves or looters come to you during the night, won't they steal only until they've had enough? You will be ruined. If people come to pick your grapes, won't they leave a few grapes behind? But you, Esau, will lose everything. Even your hidden treasures will be looted. All your allies will force you to leave your land. The people who are at peace with you will deceive you. Those who eat food with you will set traps for you, and you won't even know about it. On that day, I will destroy the wise people of Edom and take wisdom away from Esau's mountain, declares the Lord. Teman, your warriors will be terrified. Everyone on Esau's mountain will be slaughtered." God brings a charge against Edom. Obadiah is the shortest book in the Old Testament, only 21 verses. There are many biblical scholars who believe that this little book was written just after the destruction of Jerusalem. I have taken you through this process backward, from Nehemiah and the rebuilding of the torn down walls to show the total destruction of Jerusalem by Babylon. And as you stand with Nehemiah on those torn down walls to look back at what got them, the Israelites, to that point of standing in all that rubble and despair. It didn't happen overnight, and it didn't happen by accident. There are many who feel that this book of Obadiah is not worth reading and that it would not be missed if it were omitted from the Bible. However, this important message is primary. It is pertinent. It is practical. And it is poignant. It is a message that can be geared into this day in which we are living, in the here and the now. It is a season we must learn unless we want to find ourselves standing in a modern day rubble that as Nehemiah and Ezra had been. Obadiah's prophecy is of devastating judgment against the little kingdom of Edom. Obadiah tells us immediately, bluntly, and to the point that this is a vision given to him by God himself. So who was Obadiah? He is one of the minor prophets about whom we know absolutely nothing. His name was a very common one in Israel, and it means servant of Jehovah. Edom is the key to this little book, and so we shall have to go back to Genesis to determine the identity of Edom. In Genesis, where we have the record of the generations of Esau, notice this comment. Now, these are the generations of Esau. Who is Edom? That is the record that is given to us here, and it is repeated 3 times by God. So when God repeats himself, he is usually trying to get our attention and convey a very important matter to us. He is reminding Israel not to forget that the Edomites have their source in Esau. And since it is in the Bible, I believe that God wants it there to tell you and me here today the lessons that we need to learn and understand. The Edomites were those who were descended from Esau, just as the Israelites are those who are descended from Jacob. The story of Esau is that of a twin brother, sons of Isaac and Rebekah. The boys were not identical twins. Actually, they were opposite. The record given back in Genesis 25 begins as Rebekah is about to give birth to these twins. And the children struggled together within her. And she said, "If it be so, why am I thus?" And she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said to her, "Two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. And the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger." From the very beginning, these two brothers were struggling against each other. Esau was an outdoorsman who loved to hunt, and Jacob would rather stay in the house and learn to cook. Jacob had a spiritual discernment that Esau did not have. Esau was a man of the flesh and did not care for spiritual things. In fact, he so disregarded his birthright that he traded it to Jacob for a bowl of soup. Esau didn't sell his birthright because he was so hungry he was about to perish, nor because there wasn't anything else to eat in that grand house of Isaac, but because his was a desire of the flesh, and he was willing to trade all of his spiritual inheritance for a whim of the moment. In that day, the son who was blessed by his father and was past the birthright by his father was the one who was in contact with God and was the priest of the family and tribe. He was the man who had covenant from God. In effect, Esau said, "I would rather have a bowl of soup than have a relationship with God." This story is an illustration of a great truth for all believers today. A believer has two natures within him, and they are struggling with each other and against each other. Paul says, "For the flesh lusteth," or wars, "against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would." These are the two natures of the believer: the new nature which loves the things of God, and the old nature which loves the things of the world. They are opposed to each other. Sitting Bull, a great Sioux chief, once said that within a man there are two great dogs, vicious fighting dogs. They're always fighting against each other. Someone asked Sitting Bull then, "Which one is winning?" Sitting Bull wisely said, "It's the one you feed the most. That's the one that wins." I think Paul would have liked that, and maybe Sitting Bull learned that from one of the missionaries. But Esau pictures the flesh, the old nature, and Jacob pictures the spirit, the new nature. The name Edom means red or sunburned. A sunburn occurs when the skin is able to absorb the rays of light except for the rays that make it red. The sunburned man is in Scripture as the man who could not absorb the light of heaven, and it burned him. Having seen Esau in the first book of the Old Testament, look now at the last book of the Old Testament and read this strange language. We were going through Lamentations today, looking at, this week in Bible study, looking at some of the language that God had there that kind of makes us look at God in a different way. But in here, in the last book of the Bible, it says, "I have loved you, saith the Lord. Yet ye say, wherein hast thou loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, saith the Lord? Yet I loved Jacob, and I hated Esau." This is a strange thing for God to say. At least it seems to be a strange thing for us to believe that God says that I loved Jacob and hated Esau. it immediately presents a problem. Through this last year, I have tried to guide you on a journey to see the real God and the real Jesus Christ. We began in Revelation seeing Jesus as the Almighty and all-powerful King of Kings and Lord of Lords, standing before the and commanding millions upon millions of God's created beings. In this journey, I have tried to get you to see the real God, not the God of fairy tales preached from most of our pulpits today, that God that is only love, but this God who also hates and destroys. I think it is important for you to have a realistic understanding of this Jesus and this God, because I fear we will see them both very, very soon. And they won't be coming as the God of love, believe me. But you won't believe me, I know. And sadly, many of you will face the wrath of God instead. I would that you would be removed from this world before that wrath is experienced. It will be a terrible thing to witness and go through. A student once approached Dr. Griffith Thomas with this question. He said, "Dr. Thomas, I'm having a problem with this statement in Malachi. I can't understand why God says he hated Esau, because all of us have a problem with this idea, this concept of God hating." Dr. Thomas replied, "Young man, I'm having a promise with that also, but with that verse also, but my problem is different from yours. I can understand why God hated Esau, but I cannot understand why he loved Jacob." Well, the thing that lends importance to the little book of Obadiah is the only place in the Word of God where we find the explanation of why God hated Esau. And I think that that's going to be very important for us to understand. According to the book of Genesis, Esau bound himself by marriage to the Hittites and the Hivites and both Canaanite tribes, the Amalekites and the Ishmaelites. Edom was also joined politically with Moab and the Hagarites and the Gebal and Ammon and Amalek and Philistia, which is the Philistines Philistia and Tyre, and then Assyria joins them, specifically helping that where they specifically they had helped the children of Lot. Nevertheless, all of these different people are among the major players in the Middle East today. These are people from whom the jihadist and the Islamic fundamentalists hail, making up what is known as the Arab or Muslim world. What was the great sin of Edom, which brought about God's judgment upon her? "The pride of thine heart hath deceived thee, thou that dwelleth in the cliffs of the rocks, whose habitation is high, that saith in his heart, who shall bring me down to the ground?" What was the behavior for which God hated Edom? It was pride. I am confident that the minute I say this, that many of you watching are going to say, "Is that all? Pride is bad, but it's not really that bad, is it?" Let me illustrate to you how we today have things all out of proportion concerning sin. Suppose that I knew of a certain Christian who was drinking very heavily, and that I came in to ask your advice as to what his church should do with him. I'm sure that you would say that he ought to be put out of the membership of the church. Now suppose that I told you of an officer of a church who was caught by the police the other night in a supermarket as he was breaking into a safe. I am sure you would say he ought to be put out of the church and that he ought to be disciplined. Suppose, though, that I told you that I knew of a certain church member who was filled with pride, who was one of the proudest persons I had ever met. I dare say that you would not suggest that he be put out of the church. Many who have a very tender heart would say, "I think the pastor should talk to him and tell him what's wrong. that it's wrong to have pride, but it's not such a bad sin after all. At least, it's one that doesn't show. It's not like getting drunk. It's not like stealing. It's not like lying. And so we relegate pride down to a lower position. But would I surprise you if I told you that in the sight of God, pride is a much worse sin than getting drunk? Now, the Bible does have a great deal to say about the sin of drunkenness. God condemns drunkenness. It contributed to the downfall of Israel and Babylon and the kingdom of Alexander the Great and Rome. It has brought down all the great nations of the world, and it will bring down this nation, ours, as well. But many of you, but may I say to you, in God's sight, pride is worse than drunkenness. This is something which gets right down to where we live today. This is right where the bat hits the ball. This is where the plane of your life and my life touches down on the runway of the life of God. We are given here a proper perspective concerning pride. Pride is the sin of sins. It is one of the worst sins of all. It is something that Scripture condemns above everything. God has said that He hates pride, and if that is the thing that Edom is eaten up with, God can say, Edom, Esau, have I hated because of his pride. Notice that the writer of Proverbs says these six things that the Lord hate, yea, even seven are an abomination unto him. And then he gives us this list. 1, a proud look. 2, a lying tongue. 3, hands that shed innocent blood. 4, an heart that devises wicked imaginations. 5, feet that be swift in running to mischief. 6, a false witness that speaketh lies. And 7, and he that soweth discord among the brethren. Do you see what is number 1 on God's hate parade? A proud look. This is not all that God has to say about pride. God says that he resists the proud, but he is always on the side of the humble. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, and arrogancy, and the evil way, and the forward mouth do I hate. John tells us, the pride of life is not of the Father. Where does the pride of life come from? If there is anything that comes from the devil, that is, a great many sins today have pride of race. A great many saints today have pride of race, pride of faith, pride of grace. They are even proud they have been saved by grace. Your salvation ought not to make you proud. It is not something to brag about. It is something about which to glorify God, and it is something that should humble you. Aren't you ashamed of yourself that you have to be saved by grace because you are such a miserable sinner? I wish I had something to offer God for salvation, but I have nothing. Therefore, I must be saved by grace, and I cannot even boast of that. There are too many people boasting of the fact that they have been sinners. God gives grace to the humble. Paul writes, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. What kind of mind did he have? He had a lowliness of mind. He said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. Pride, after all, was the sin of Satan. He said, Satan said, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will be like the Most High. Pride of heart is the attitude of a life that declares its ability to live without God. This is the place where the rubber meets the road, where we and our society are today, making this awful declaration that we can live and survive without God. in making that declaration, we place ourselves right next to Satan and Esau, a people who don't care for God at all. Esau had become a great nation and had declared its ability to live without God. Thou that dwellest in the cliffs of the rocks, whose habitation is high, that saith in his heart, who shall bring me down to the ground? Esau lived in a very unique place. He lived in the rocky mountain fastness of the rock-hewn city of Petra. We've seen many times, I'm sure, many of you have seen the pictures of Petra carved in the rocks. It is a ready-made city hewn out of the rocks. There was many thousands of people that lived there. It is protected by an entranceway, which is very narrow in places. A horse and rider can get through, but it's just a bit of twisting, and with just a bit of twisting and turning. It was therefore a city which could easily be defended. Everything was secure. It was like the First National Bank, in that many of the nations of the world deposited vast sums of gold and silver there because they felt that the city could never fall, could never be taken. They dwelt in the cliffs of the rocks. They were living in great buildings which were hewn out of rock, of solid rock, inside this great canyon and up and down the sides of it. They thought they were perfectly secure. They didn't need God, so they severed all relationship with God. They had seceded from the government of God. They had revolted and rebelled against him. Now, wait a second. Is there a modern-day Petra trying to govern and dictate to the world? What about Wall Street and big banks and that almighty dollar? The Edomites were going to overthrow God as Satan had attempted to do, and they were going to become deity. They were going to handle the business that God was supposed to handle. And though thou set thy nest among the stars, this was the sin of Satan. For he sought to exalt his throne above the stars, and God said, thence will I bring thee down. How many people today are attempting to run their lives as if there were no God? Leaning on Wall Street and dollars instead of God. They feel that they don't need God and they live without him. The interesting thing is that when God made us, he didn't put a steering wheel on any of us. Why? Because he wants to be the one that's guiding our lives. God wants us to come to him for salvation first, and then he wants to take charge of our lives. When you and I run our lives, we put ourselves in the place of God. We are in the driver's seat. We make ourselves the captains of our own little ships or our own little planes. And we are going through the water or the air just to suit ourselves. That is pride. And anyone who reaches that position, if he continues in it, is committing a sin which is fatal, because it means he will go into a lost eternity. You may have heard the story of the pig in Kentucky that got out of its pig pen. He wandered out in the woods and found a still. Mash had leaked out of the still, and the pig began to eat it and also to drink the liquid that was leaking out with it. The pig got really drunk. He couldn't walk, and he sprawled right down in the mud. He stayed there for 24 hours until he sobered up. Then, as he stood up and grunted off, he was heard to say, I'll never play being a man again. Someone else expressed it this way. How well do I remember? 'Twas in the bleak December, as I was strolling down the streets in manly pride, when my heart began to flutter and I fell into the gutter, and a pig came up and lay down by my side. As I lay there in the gutter, my heart still all a flutter, a man passing by did chance to say, "You can tell a man that boozes by the company he chooses." And the pig got up and slowly walked away. Remember that God said to the Edomites, "Though thou exalt thyself as the eagle, and though thou set thy nest among the stars, thence will I bring thee down." Obadiah says that if a thief came to rob them, he would take only what he wanted, what he could carry, what he needed. He wouldn't take everything. That would also be true of someone who came to gather the grapes. He would leave some grapes behind. But God says to Edom, "When I judge you, the destruction will be complete." God has put Esau under a microscope, and God says, "Come look. Look through the word of God and look at this man. I hate him. Why do I hate him? It is because of his pride of life. He has turned his back on me and has declared his ability to live without me. That is the pride of life." Frankly, when I read the story and reread the story of Esau back in the book of Genesis, I don't quite understand it. But although I miss it in Genesis, I sure don't miss it here. I can now take the microscope and go back and look at Esau and see why he wanted to trade his birthright for a bowl of soup. It was for the very simple reason that the birthright meant he would be the priest in his family, and it meant a relationship to God. And frankly, Esau would rather have had a bowl of soup than have had a relationship with God. He did not want to be either the priest of his family or have a relationship with God. When you reach that place, you have sunk to the level of the pig and that got down in the gutter. This is my great worry for us today. I am seeing all around me Esau's sin of pride, whereby we state quite openly and without shame that we just don't need God in our lives, that we have built up for ourselves a place amongst Wall Street and dollars and all of the things that we use to protect us, whereby we just don't need God any longer. This summer was a really eye-opening and tragic summer. There was earthquakes all around us, and they're still going on. Hurricanes, typhoons, tornadoes, tsunamis, mudslides, great fires, all are meant to get our attention. God says, "Don't put your trust in these things. They can be destroyed. Put your trust in me." You know, what prophecy says will be the next great calamity to befall us, if you study prophecy, the next great thing that's going to happen to the world, it will be the crash of the banking and the financial empires of the world. Then, what will you put your faith in? Edom felt that they were well protected in their Rocky Mountain fastness, in the beautiful city of Petra. They made human sacrifices instead of worshiping God. The Temanites of verse 9 were noted for their courage. They were the Spartans of the area. But God says he will bring them all to nothing, as he will everyone who does not worship him or his son Jesus Christ. And you have to tie that to what it says in Revelations, when it says that after the church is removed and the times become so bad that the people are going to gather in the caves, they're going to gather under the mountains, and they're going to pray that the mountains fall on them. They're so fearful of the tragedies all around them, the judgment that's coming. We live in a world where we don't quite need God. Right? Does that make any sense? None at all. I can't imagine a day where I don't need God. But look at our churches today. There are empty seats, empty chairs, and people doing all kinds of things on Sunday instead of worshiping God. God said he hates people who do not worship him. And the world today, the pastors today have this mamby-pamby idea that God is just going to come in and save everybody and make everything all right. But you know, Petra was destroyed. And Petra will be all of those who do not trust in Jesus Christ. Our hymn of dedication this morning is Give Thanks. Please come forward for our tithes and offerings this morning. One of the things I missed when I was thinking about the praises that we would give is I really feel that we are blessed by our young people who are singing and helping with the service. What a blessing. Will you please rise? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you give us. We thank you for this offering, and we just thank you for each and every person here. We thank you for our young people and for all that they do. We ask you to continue to bless this church. Guide us and lead us and help us be the people that we need to be. Go with us and all of those that are watching from home. Keep your hand upon us as we go our way this week and through the Thanksgiving holiday. Give us the opportunity to look at the blessings that we have in our life and give you thanks for them, for they come by your hand and not by any other. Help us all to come to the table on Thanksgiving and bow our head and say grace, as it is proper to do. Guide us and direct us this week. Give us the opportunity to witness to someone, to invite someone to youth group or Bible study or church, and just give us the ability to live our lives so that other people will see how we live and want to be like us. Give us each the opportunity to witness, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, to tell someone how much Jesus means to us, especially this week, when we live this week in Thanksgiving. Watch over us and guide us. Strengthen us. And make us be all that we can be. Keep your hand upon us. In Jesus' name, and for his sake we pray. Amen.